trace nor stain of sin. See the true and better Adam come to save the hell-bound man. Christ the great and sure fulfillment of the law.
Hello everybody, and welcome again to another COVID Sunday morning service. We're all, I'm sure, being stretched beyond what we imagined we could be with this lockdown and the circumstances in which we find ourselves. But it is lovely just to be together again like this on a Sunday morning and enjoy some time together, and to, in a short while, be looking around the Word of God. If you're visiting with us today, ordinarily you're not connected with Straid Church in any way, shape or form, I'd like to particularly welcome you. And again, it doesn't matter where you are in your journey, your faith journey at this time in your life. You may be a Christian, you may not be a Christian, you may be a believer, or you may be an unbeliever, and or you may be a Christian for many, many years. It doesn't matter where you are in your journey, I'd like to extend a warm welcome to you to our service today. Now, at this point, as our custom is, we always open our services in a word of prayer. We like to address God and present ourselves to Him and to petition Him for His help in different ways. And we're going to do that at this time. And I'm going to hand over to Matt. And Matt's going to open in prayer for us. Thank you very much, Matt.
Dear God, thank you for another Sunday. Thank you for how we can still have a church service on a Sunday morning. Although we cannot meet together, we can meet with you in our own homes. Thank you, Lord, for the good weather we have been experiencing. And thank you that it enables us to get outside and enjoy your creation. Thank you, God, for the time we have had during lockdown to draw close to you, to read our Bibles, to study your word, and to be able to pray and talk to you through uncertain times. Thank you, Lord, that you hear our prayers, you listen to them, and you answer them, maybe not always in the way we want, but in a way that will glorify you. Thank you, Lord, that there's been lockdown easing in the past few days and weeks. Thank you that we are now able to see our families and our friends a bit more. Thank you that things are getting a bit back towards normal. But I just pray as well that as these measures ease, that you will continue to be with us. You will continue to keep us safe and you will help us to be wise and not spread this virus. Lord, just be with those in our fellowship who have been unwell, those who are bereaved, those waiting for results, and those who are home alone. Be with them. Let them know that they can rely on you and call upon you anytime, and you are listening. Lord, thank you that we have these services on a Sunday. Thank you, Lord, for all the hard work that is put in behind the scenes to make these possible. Lord, be with Paul now as he opens your word and speaks to us. I pray that you just be with him and bless him, bless those who listen, and speak to those who listen but maybe do not believe in you. I pray you will speak to them through this, draw them to you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Matt, thank you very much for saying that opening prayer for us. And as usual, we have a children's address slot in our service. And at this point, I'm going to hand over to Julie, and Julie's going to be bringing the children's address for us today. Now, just after Julie has shared with us, boys and girls, I want you to just watch out for the song that's going to play. It's from the CEF Online Holiday Bible Club. And some of you may already have heard the song. You may know it. And hopefully, if you do, you'll be able to sing along to it as well. Thank you.
Hello boys and girls, it's really lovely to be here today with you, sharing from the Bible with you all. I hope you're all well. So, I wonder if many of you watched our service last week and you would have seen John out in his garden. Now John said he was going to get a ball into a cup, and then he paused and we had to predict what was going to happen. I wonder, did many of you get it right? Well, I got it really, really, really wrong. I thought he was going to throw the ball, it was going to knock the cup off the table, then the ball would be on the ground, bouncing around, and John would have to crawl around the ground looking for the cup and the ball. We would all have had a wee giggle, but that's not what happened. I got it so, so wrong. So John told us about somebody in the Bible who never gets things wrong. Can you remember who that is? Yes, it's God. John told us that God knows the future and he controls the future. John also told us about a prophet called Isaiah. Now, Isaiah told the people of Israel many things about Jesus and who was going to come in the future. Now, Isaiah lived about 700 years before Jesus, maybe even more than 700 years. And imagine the people of Israel waiting and waiting and waiting every day for Jesus to come. Imagine how long that would have felt. Well, I'm going to show you something, boys and girls, that I've been waiting ages and ages and ages for. And I've been waiting for this from the beginning of lockdown. And it just seems like so long because I'm really looking forward to it. Now, I don't want you to laugh when I show you this, okay? Do you think I can trust you? I'm not too sure. Right, I'm going to show you and you try and guess what I've been waiting for. Are you ready? So, I've been waiting for the hairdressers to open. That's what my fringe looks like when I haven't got it tied back. And I've only been waiting for a couple of months for the hairdressers to open. Imagine the Israelites waiting and thinking, is it going to be today? Is it going to be today? And over 700 years passes before Jesus actually came to earth as a baby boy. So, we're going to play a wee game today. And it's a wee bit like a lift the flap game. And we're going to be a wee bit like detectives. We're going to have a look at some of the things that Isaiah said, and then we're going to check the New Testament to see where we can find out that these things really happened, because we know that God really does know and control the future. Okay, you ready for the first one? The first one's the blue one. So, Isaiah tells us in chapter 11, verse 1, a shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse. Now, I thought that was really, really, really strange thing. And I was thinking, what on earth does that mean? But if we think back to our story of Ruth, we can see in the story of Ruth that Ruth married Boaz. And then later on in Matthew, we find out the whole family tree of Jesus. So Ruth and Boaz had a wee baby called Obed. Obed had a son called Jesse, that Isaiah talked about up here. Jesse had a son called David, And away, way, way down the same family tree came Jesus. So this shows us in the Bible, in Matthew, that the shoot did come up from the stump of Jesse, that Jesus was a relative of Jesse. And that shows us that God really does know and control the future. Okay, the second one, are you ready for it? The red one? So, the next thing that Isaiah told us, the Lord himself will give you a sign. A baby will be born. We will call him Emmanuel. And that's in Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14. Now, if we look in the New Testament, in the book of Matthew, we can see here that Mary was going to have a baby. And one night, Joseph had a dream. And an angel came to him in the dream and told him that Mary was going to have a baby boy and he would save all the people from their sins. And all this took place to fulfill what God had said through Isaiah, that Jesus would be born and be called Emmanuel. And can you remember what Emmanuel means? That's right, God with us. So here we have Isaiah over 700 years ago telling us what God had told him about Jesus coming to save us all from our sins, because God knows and controls the future. Okay, ready for the yellow one? Now, Isaiah told us in chapter 53, verse 3, he was despised and rejected by mankind. Now, boys and girls, we know lots and lots of people didn't like Jesus. And whenever I was thinking about this, I thought to when he was born and he was a tiny, tiny, tiny baby. And if you remember, the wise men were talking to Herod, and Herod said to them, when you find where this baby is, come back and tell me, because I want to go and worship him myself. And boys and girls, did King Herod really want to go and worship Jesus? That's right, he did not. He wanted to kill him. So Isaiah was right, telling us what God had said. He was rejected, despised and rejected by mankind. And this happened over 700 years before Jesus was even born, because God knows and controls the future. So, you ready for the next one? I'm going to move over here. Okay, so the next one is the green one. Okay, and this one is in Isaiah chapter 9, verses 1 and 2. He will honour Galilee. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. And if we look in the New Testament, in the book of John, Jesus said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. And here we have Isaiah, over 700 years ago, telling us that Jesus was the great light and that people would not be walking in darkness anymore if they follow Jesus. I think that's amazing. Now, ready for the purple one? Okay. Now, this one tells us in Isaiah chapter 53, verse 5 and 6, but he was pierced for our transgressions, and by his wounds we are healed. The Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. And if we look down here, we know, boys and girls, that Jesus died on the cross. Jesus took the blame for our sins so that we could be forgiven. And in Matthew chapter 20, verse 28, it tells us that Jesus came to give his life as a ransom for many. So Jesus took our blame and died for us so that we could be forgiven. And Isaiah told us this message from God over 700 years before Jesus was born. And all because God knows and controls the future. Ready for the last one? Okay. So the last one is in Isaiah chapter 9, verse 7. He will reign from that time on and forever. And boys and girls, we all know that after Jesus died and was buried, he rose 3 days later. And he lives today. Jesus is still alive today. And we also know that from Matthew chapter 28, verse 20, Jesus said, "And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." So again, Isaiah told us that over 700 years ago, and it shows us that God knows and controls the future. So God sent all these messages before Jesus was born. God promised over and over again that he would send Jesus to save us from our sins. And guess what? God kept every one of those promises. God always keeps his promises, and he really does know and control the future. Thank you all so much for listening. Bye-bye. God is living.
Thank you, Julie, for sharing with us today, and I hope that you all enjoyed that song that played there for us. Now, folks, I have a couple of announcements again for you this week, and the first one I'd like to share with you is just a card of thanks from David and Mark Cathcart, and I'd like to just read it to you. David and Mark write, "We would like to express our sincere thanks to our church family in Straid for your prayerful support over the last 6 or 7 months during Anastasia's illness and passing. We also want to acknowledge the practical support given to the family by way of food, meals, and gifts. Your kindness has brought a great deal of comfort and relief during this difficult time. We would also like to thank those who sent cards, text messages, and kindly donated to OMS to further the spread of the gospel among the young people of Ukraine. We trust this acknowledgement will be accepted as a token of our appreciation." So just a card of thanks to our church from David and Mark, with the recent passing of Anastasia. Folks, just to move on, our second announcement today really is just thank you again to all the volunteers in our church who very kindly do errands, run a number of errands for folk in the fellowship, and help in all sorts of different ways just to facilitate church life and meeting the needs of those who are in need. Thirdly, the food bank. Again, thank you for all the donations that have been passed through our church, and can I encourage us all just to keep making those donations, keep the non-perishables coming, as the need out there doesn't diminish at all. And next, now folks, due to the COVID-19 pandemic, this year's Holiday Bible Club won't be happening as usual. Instead, our Holiday Bible Club committee have decided that they will direct children and parents to various online programs that will be available in the incoming weeks. So please just watch the church website for details in this regard. You can also find the details for the next Holiday Bible Club that's going to be available online. And this is going to be done by Colin Tinsley. Now this starts tomorrow. That'll be Monday the 29th of June. And you can actually find details of that on our own church website. Or if you wanted to, you could just go directly to Colin's YouTube channel and pick up those details there as well. So that's just a wee detail there for you regarding the Holiday Bible Club. Folks, I'm sure many of you have heard the talk that churches are reopening as from Monday the 29th of June, and churches are going to be able to continue or reconvene and host worship services as they did in the past. Now, our church leadership are going to meet in due course to discuss how we are going to implement this in our own fellowship. And we will then keep everyone informed. We'll keep the congregation informed through the various links that we're all connected to in one way or another. And that'll just bring you all up to speed with how we're going to move forward in this regard. And now the final announcement that I have today is just again our regular feature is the sunflower seed. And you can see this little fella here is doing quite well, not as good as others, I believe, but I'm very proud of him. And you can see he's got a little neighbor here that just isn't doing quite as well, but this guy is really coming on well. I'm sure most of yours are doing a lot better than this over here, and just keep going, and hopefully before too long we'll be able to get them planted in the garden. And I understand that they all need a bit of support as well. They need something just to support them as they stand. Those stems just sometimes can snap if the wind picks up. So boys and girls, keep watering them, keep feeding them. And if you have already transplanted them into your garden, just keep a good eye on them and make sure that they don't get hurt in the storms that come through our garden so often. So there we go. That's the sunflower update for you for this week as well. So we're going to turn into our Bibles, and our reading today is from Genesis chapter 22 and verse 1 and 2. Just a short reading. We're backtracking a little bit here to 2 weeks ago when we last met and focused our attention on Abraham. So Genesis chapter 22 and verse 1 and 2, and the word of God reads as follows. Now it came to pass after these things that God tested Abraham and said to him, Abraham. And he said, Here I am. Then he said, Take now your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains of which I shall tell you. So Abraham rose early in the morning and saddled his donkey and took two of his young men with him and Isaac his son. And just as far as that point. Now the last time we had focused on Abraham, and we met him in Ur of the Chaldees. That's where the narrative picks up in chapter 12 of the book of Genesis, and the city was called Ur of the Chaldees or Ur of the Chaldeans. Now we know that Ur was a very sophisticated and modern city in its day. It enjoyed the benefit of being a politically important city as well as a commercial hub in the ancient world. It was located in modern day southern Iraq in close proximity to the mouth of the mighty Euphrates River on the Persian Gulf. Now, the inhabitants of Ur, we know, were predominantly descendants of Ham, Noah's third son, Ham, and they were known as the Hamites. And Abram's family were descendants of Shem, one of Noah's other sons. And this family of his had apparently relocated at some point to come and dwell amongst the Hamites, who preoccupied the area around southern Iraq. Now, we know that Shem, like his father before him, Noah, was a God-fearing man, and it seems that a residual influence along those lines had been transmitted down the generations to Abram himself. And so by the time we're introduced to Abram in Genesis chapter 12, we must realize that Abram himself was a God-fearing man and who was living amongst an idolatrous and very pagan generation. And it's into this particular scenario that God speaks to Abraham in the reading that we've just looked at. And in fact, earlier in chapter 12, in chapter 12, God speaks to him. And this is what the Lord says to him while he's living in Ur of the Chaldees as a God-fearing man, just like his forefather Shem. And I'll read from Genesis chapter 12 for you, verse 1. Now the Lord had said to Abram, get out of your country, from your family and from your father's house to a land I will show you. I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great. And you shall be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse him who curses you, and in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. So Abram departed as the Lord had spoken to him. And that little reading there is really our introduction as readers of the Bible to this man, Abram. This is how God has chosen to, as it were, bring him out, you know, to front and center stage in the scriptures. And so we find him, or we're introduced to him in this context of a call on his life. God had placed a call on Abram's life, and everything that follows from this point on in chapter 12 in Abram's life, it can all be traced back to this call that God put on his life, right? Now, the call of God on this man's life. Now, as is the case in all generations, the call of God comes only to those who are loyal to God, to those who've been prepared by him, as he summons them to awake to their true destiny, to take their place in God's great work of redemption in this darkened world in which we live. And this is what Abram's call looked like. The call of God on his life looked like this, and I'm taking it straight from Genesis 12 and verse 1. Get out of your country, from your family, and from your father's house to a land that I will show you. Nothing very romantic and exciting about that, is it? It's just get out of your country, from your family, and from your father's house to a land that I will show you. And I think it's interesting that God introduces us to Abram in this particular context. God speaking to him like this, God putting a call on his life in this particular way. And it speaks to us, it gives us an indication of the extent to which God sees fit and appropriate to impose himself in the life of a man who follows him and who has been worshiping him all these years while living in a pagan land. And that says something also to us about the way God can impose himself in our lives. And if you're a Christian today, you need to realize that God is in fact God, and he's God over, not just over creation, but he's God over your life as well. And if he chooses to, God can place a call on your life. And it may well be that God at this point in your life is busy preparing, or has been preparing you for something that he wants you to do for him, something specific. God wants to maybe harness you as you are, and perhaps your family with you, and lead you to your true destiny, the greater destiny that he has in mind for your life. And so, you know, we need to be aware that this is how God rolls. This is how God operates. He, from time to time, as he sovereignly chooses, will place his hand, place his finger on people's lives, and he will lead them out and call them out into following him and into the great work of the cause of the gospel. And so, you know, that principle, that New Testament principle we find where, you know, you have to prove yourself faithful and little before God sort of, you know, gives you a greater challenge. And we find that with Abram here. So clearly, you know, this man, he's been faithful in his life and in his relationship with God up until this point. And now we find that God was giving him an opportunity to be faithful in much. Yes, he'd been proved faithful in the little, and now God was going to give him an opportunity to prove himself to be faithful in greater things. And so, having proved himself faithful and steadfast in Chaldea, God was now calling him out to play a great part in the history of the world. And of course, this man is revered both in Christianity and in Islam, as well as in Judaism. Abraham is a revered historical figure, and God was going to use him to bring about a dramatic change in the history of the world. And it was going to be through Abraham ultimately that the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God, was going to come onto the world scene. And so God's choice of servants is never arbitrary, right? But is always based on some previous traits in those whom he summons from amongst their peers to be his servants and to be his aid in his great cause. You know, Isaiah the prophet, looking back to Abram's call as he speaks to the nation in his day and age, in Isaiah 51 and verse 1 and 2, this is what he says. And he's citing God at this point. God is speaking through Isaiah the prophet in Isaiah 51 verse 1 and 2. Listen to me, all who hope for deliverance, all who seek the Lord. Consider the rock from which you were cut, the quarry from which you were mined. Yes, think about Abraham, your ancestor, and Sarah, who gave birth to your nation. Abram was only one man when I called him, but when I blessed him, he became a great nation. And so Isaiah brings to life the obscurity that is associated with Israel's humble beginnings. All the descendants of Abraham have a pedigree described in less than glamorous terms here in Isaiah 51. They were cut from a rock. They were mined from a quarry. And Abram was only one man when God called him. You know, God called one man, and it was through this one man that God brought about such a dramatic change in the history of the world. It was through Abraham that God introduced the nation of Israel to the world. And it was through the nation of Israel that God eventually dispatched his own son to come into the world to be the savior of all men and women. And so these very humble beginnings, this insignificance, this obscurity that is associated with Abraham in the scriptures belies the fact that this man was in fact a giant, and it was God who raised him to the heights of service that ultimately he came to fulfill as time passed. Now, the call to leave Ur on the part of the Lord was no doubt preceded by long seasons of trials that God in his providence allowed Abram to endure. You know, he'd obviously gone through numerous pressures, numerous tests had come across his path as God was busy training him and honing him and refining him and preparing him ultimately for the work to which he was going to call him. Now, you must just bear in mind that our initial Bible reading was a monstrous affair. All right, this monstrous test, this hideous test that God brought upon Abram's life to sacrifice his own boy, to burn him as a sacrifice to God, okay? That's where we're aiming for. So we're talking about the run-up to that event, and the journey starts here with this man's call, okay? So this is important because his call had an incredible impact on the life that he was to lead up until the point where God was going to ask this monstrous test of him. All right. So, you know, and there was obviously preparations before God called him and God led him out into the great cause into which he ultimately would go. And it was only after these numerous tests, it was only after these long seasons of trials, and only after he had suffered numerous pressures that God began with calling this man that Abram, in fact, was ready to be confronted with the wonderful person of God himself. Okay, you know, when we read through the text prior to Genesis chapter 12, there's no indication really of Abram having such a profound interaction with God, where God revealed himself to this man in such a profound way that he just was prepared to just drop everything and go as God bid him do, right? And so he wasn't ready to be confronted by God until he had endured all the preparatory lessons that God had, you know, prepared for him, or that God had providentially allowed him to endure. And I'll tell you, the wonderful thing about the Lord is that he is so skillful in preparing his servants. God prepared Abram in Ur of the Chaldees. God can prepare a man in Belfast in Northern Ireland. God can prepare a man or a woman on a farm in Northern Ireland. God can prepare a young person in school in Northern Ireland. And it doesn't matter where we are in the world, God can take up the circumstances in our lives, and as difficult and as painful as they are, sometimes it's bullying, sometimes we're mocked. You know, a person can be mocked because of their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. We can be belittled and we can be scorned. And you know, folks, we mustn't let ourselves ever lose sight of the fact that God can take those bitter experiences in our lives, God can take those unpleasant experiences in our lives and use them to prepare us, to better prepare us to serve him. And you know, at some point it may be that God is going to intersect with your life in a very profound way, and that will leave you in no doubt that God is in fact placing his hand on your life and wants to call you into some type of Christian ministry over and above what you already are doing for him. And so in the case of Abraham, through all the changing scenes of life, through the highs and through the lows, he was being prepared for this very great moment when the Lord would come to him and would appear to him and would call him into the great work. One commentator puts it like this, that for Abraham, at last, the glory of God appeared to him. And now, while the light had been steadily growing in his vision, it was only at this point that the sun, as it were, broke out from behind the clouds, the obscuring clouds, and made its presence known. Now, we're not told just how it was that God appeared to Abram. God keeps that private and confidential, as it were. That was between himself and Abram. That was a very private, personal moment. And so God doesn't tell us in his word how he made himself known to Abram at that time. But we know that the impact of this upon him was so great that from the very moment, that moment forward, he had an unshakable foundation. He had an unmistakable basis for all that would lie before him for the rest of his life and for the future that lay before him that as yet was unseen, and for that country that he was allegedly traveling to that he didn't know where its whereabouts either. But this call of God, this when God made himself known to Abram in this very profound way, it did something in Abram's heart. It gave him this unshakable foundation, this unmistakable basis, this incredible platform that he would be able to base the rest of his life upon. Now, it's been said that, and I quote, the mushroom is the child of a single night, but the oak, which is a match for the tempest, is the result of long years of sun and air, of breeze and storm. And so like the oak, Abram's preparation for his personal growth and maturing was such that the man was now ready for God to reveal himself to him and call him to the great work that lay ahead. And we see this theme of people needing to be prepared, needing to be qualified, as it were, to be involved in the work of God. We see this in the New Testament. Paul writes, you know, to younger Timothy in chapter 3 and verse 6 of his first letter to this young fella, and he gives him advice in regard to appointing elders or pastors in a church. And he says an elder must not be a new believer. He mustn't be a novice, because he might become proud and the devil would cause him to fall. And so we see that kind of that same principle in the life of Abram, you know, where God had prepared him, God had matured him, God had taught him incredible lessons about life and about himself and about God. And it was only after he reached a sort of a certain level of maturity that then God came and revealed himself to the man and extended that call to him. Now, we can fast forward a little bit and to Genesis chapter 22, where we are confronted with another command from God. So the first command in Genesis chapter 12 was to leave your country, leave your parents, leave your family, leave your countrymen, and go to a destination that you don't know where it is just yet, right? So that was the first great command that and the call that God put in his life. But here in Genesis chapter 22, this is entirely something else, right? And I'll read it again. Now, it came to pass after these things that God tested Abraham and said to him, Abraham. And he said, here I am. Then he said, take now your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains of which I shall tell you. And all of a sudden, our theology potentially can run into problems at this point. You know, yes, we can appreciate the call, you know, of God upon someone's life to become a key figure, you know, to become a missionary, to become a pastor, to, you know, to play a significant role in the redemption story. And we can grasp that. We can appreciate that. And we can appreciate Abram's prompt response, right? We understand the concept of obedience and, you know, God commands and we obey. And these aren't foreign concepts to us. We can get our heads around that. But for God to ask him effectively to slay his own son and then burn his corpse as an offering to God, well, folks, that's a step too far, isn't it? How on earth can God ask a man to do something as reprehensible as making a sacrifice of their child? And this, you know, this really opens up a domain with God that perhaps doesn't fit very comfortably with the modern reader. You know, is God fickle? is that the God of the Bible? Is he this fickle, sovereign God who just comes down and asks people to do crazy stuff like this? You know, and this is where we run into a bit of a snag, don't we? Because in Psalm 103, you know, in verse 13, we read the Lord is like a father to his children, tender and compassionate to those who fear him. For he knows how weak we are. He remembers we are only dust. Our days on earth are like grass, like wildflowers. We bloom and die. The wind blows and we're gone as though we have never been here. But the love of the Lord remains forever with those who fear him. His salvation extends to the children's children and of those who are faithful to his covenant, of those who obey his commandments. It's like, you know, so the psalmist uses, you know, this father metaphor here to describe God to us. And this is a metaphor that we can really easily identify with. We understand the concept of a father. We understand, you know, fathers love their children and they look after them, provide for them. Well, that's what they're meant to do anyway. I know there are a lot who don't. And so the psalmist here likens God to a father figure who is tender, who is compassionate, and he knows our weaknesses and that our lives are so fleeting. But with Abram, God speaks and says to him, take now your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer them there as a burnt offering. And so, you know, after reading this incident in Abram's life, you know, we might be tempted to ask to question really the veracity of the psalmist. You know, has he got it right? Is God really this you know, father-like figure with his children? Is he really tender and compassionate? Well, look what he did on Abram. You know, and of course, you know, we have the benefit of hindsight, you know, reading this scripture today. We know how the story ended, right? But Abram didn't know how the story was going to end. Sarah, his wife, didn't know how the story was going to end. Nobody knew how this was going to end. All they knew at the time, all Abram knew, was that God had told him, take your son, go down the road to the Mount Moriah, and I will show you ultimately when you get there where I want you to slay your boy, and then I want you to burn him as a sacrifice to me. So which one is it? Can you imagine this father-like figure, tender and compassionate on the one hand, but on the other hand, asking me to do a thing like this? And of course, he didn't have the benefit of hindsight, so he didn't know, right? Think of Sarah, you know, Sarah at that stage, her name hadn't been changed yet. Think of Sarah, his wife, right? How must she have felt on hearing of this command that God had given her husband? You know, and when you factor into, you know, the narrative that you know, Sarah had passed the age of childbearing by decades, and she'd come to about 90 years of age when she conceived and when this little child Isaac was born, right? So he was the child of her old age. She was an old woman. I mean, she, you know, a great-grandmother, potentially. You know, she was up in that bracket in terms of her own age. But it was then that she was actually having her first child. And so, you know, think about the years of heartache of not having her own child, the years of barrenness, and, of course, what that meant for them in that ancient, you know, Near Eastern culture, the shame of the barren womb. You know, there was a shame associated with that. There was grief, decades and decades of heartache associated with that. And then at last, this child is born to her and she's just filled with joy, you know, that God gives her and her older husband this little baby, Isaac. And of course now, you know, just into his teenage years, God is asking Abram to take this boy, this child that they'd waited so long for, take him down the road and go and put him on an altar. You know, stab him, kill him, and then burn him to death. How must they have felt? And in those moments, in those hours, in those days, how would they have reconciled the idea that God was a God of compassion, that God was a God of mercy, but here he was asking them to make a sacrifice like this, to take from them the thing that was most precious to them? I guarantee you now, if Abram could have, he would have swapped his life out for that of his boys. Hands down, he would have done that. But God never gave him that opportunity. God gave him no wriggle room at all. There was no room for maneuver. It was a clear-cut, a singular command. Take your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love, and take him down to Moriah and offer him as a sacrifice to me. And so when we think about this, you know, there is this paradox. How can someone who is tender and compassionate towards the saints command them to act in such a manner? And this is the rub. This is the heart of what we're trying to explore in this little mini-series. How is it that we can reconcile the things that God asks people to do with the fact that God is also loving and compassionate? How do we reconcile the fact that God allows terrible things to unfold in the world around us and with the ability to sovereignly step in and to, you know, cease wars and to bring about peace? Why is it that God doesn't do these things when he has the ability to do these things, and he's presented to us as one who is compassionate, as one who, like a father figure, cares for his children? And this is a tough one, isn't it? Because in truth, there aren't many families in this life that come through life unscathed, where we haven't been affected by the death of a child, or the death of a young person, or the death of a parent at a young age, or where some sort of terrible sin has taken place within the precincts of the family, and the devastation that has caused, and the ongoing effects, the knock-on effect of a single person's sinful behavior, the devastation that this brings into the home, alcohol and drugs and sexual abuse, all sorts of wicked things that go on behind closed doors in people's lives. And of course, on Sunday, everything looks great. Everybody comes out and everybody looks good. But who knows what's going on behind closed doors? And so often, you know, the question is, how can God, who is so tender and so compassionate, and he's so benevolent in his posture toward us, you know, why is it that stuff like this goes on? You know, why is it that God, you know, asks missionaries to go into different parts of the world, and there their lives, they lose their lives for the sake of the gospel? You know, and so there's this tension, and there is this difficulty for us. And so we want to talk about that. We want to sort of explore this theme, if you like, through the lens of Abram's life and some other scriptures as well. Now, as we think about this idea, this theme of compassion, you know, as the psalmist says in Psalm 103, that God, you know, he's like a father. And I'll just go back there. The Lord is like a father to his children, tender and compassionate to those who fear him. Amazing words, very comforting words, very wonderful words. But of course, in those moments when Abram was traveling down the road to Moriah with his son, I just wonder how he felt in those moments about God. And I wonder, would he have been able to put pen to paper and say, like the psalmist, yeah, the Lord is like a father to his children. He's tender and compassionate to those who fear him. I wonder how Abram would have felt about that particular verse in that moment in his life. Now, a very tenacious theme in the Hebrew Bible insists that God is compassionate by nature. Now, this insistence on the compassionate nature of God eventually inserted itself into a well-known creedal statement that we find is taken from a proclamation of Moses. And we find this recorded in Exodus chapter 34, verses 6, 7, and the first part of verse 7 as well. So Moses speaks and he says these words: the Lord, a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness, keeping steadfast love for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin. And so there we see that theme: God's compassion, God being a merciful God, God being a gracious God, God being one who is slow to anger, one who is abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. And this is what Moses says, and he says this is who God is, right? And now the penetration of this pervasiveness, of this pervasive truth, right, was so deeply entrenched within the Israelite psyche that even during moments of impending divine wrath, when God was about to spill out his wrath and judgment because of sinful behavior and as a reaction to what people have done, this particular attribute of God was cited and presented to God in an effort to try and stay the hand of judgment, you know. So you can just imagine, you know, God coming down in judgment and wrath, and at the last minute, you know, a God-fearing man stands up and says, but hold on, Lord, you know, hold on, Lord, you're a merciful God, and you're gracious, and you're slow to anger. And so, you know, on the occasion, and there's an incident recorded for us as well along those lines in Numbers chapter 14. Remember, just before the children of Israel had entered the promised land, and the 12 spies had been dispatched to go and do a recce within the promised land, and of course they came back to Moses with their report, and you know, they reported that the land was full of giants and that they would never be able to occupy the promised land on account of the walled cities and the giants that were living there, right? And of course, when this information was made public within the congregation of Israel, it sort of triggered a national rebellion, and they sought to cast Moses and Aaron out. They wanted to, in fact, stone them, all right? And so God responded in that moment, and this is what the Lord said in verse 11 and 12 of Numbers 14. And the Lord said to Moses, after this reaction, this rebellious response, right? God spoke and said to Moses, how long will these people treat me with contempt? Will they never believe me, even after all the miraculous signs I've done among them? I will disown them and destroy them with a plague. Then I will make you into a nation greater and mightier than they are. And of course, so God's going to react in judgment because of the disobedience and the lack of faith on the part of the nation of Israel. And of course, just before God unleashes the plague to destroy them, Moses cites God's compassion as grounds for God not destroying them. And we read of Moses in verse 18 of Numbers 14. He speaks to God and he says, but Lord, remember, the Lord is slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, forgiving iniquity and transgression. And so we find that this theme of God being so compassionate is deeply entrenched in the Israelite mind and in the fabric of the nation of Israel. They had this very sophisticated grasp and understanding that God was a God who was compassionate. And as we see here in this particular instance, just before it's all going to go completely sideways and God is going to unleash devastation, Moses steps in and he quotes and cites, you know, the very attribute that God had told him. He presents it back to God and says, listen, but Lord, you know, on the basis of the fact that you are slow to anger and on the basis that you are abounding in steadfast love, that you are forgiving in nature, you forgive iniquity and you forgive transgression, Lord, have mercy on us on the basis of who you are. So, and it just speaks again to the penetration of this concept and the grasp and the understanding of the Lord's compassion and the Lord's mercy in the nation of Israel. Now, very much later in Israel's history, we observe this type of language and we see that it becomes sort of a natural feature in the prayers of God's people, right? Nehemiah chapter 9, even that great gentleman Nehemiah that we've been looking at in recent months, Nehemiah chapter 9 and verse 17, he's praying and he's speaking to God. And in verse 17, he says, they refused to obey and were not mindful of the wonders that you performed among them, but they stiffened their neck and appointed a leader to return to their slavery in Egypt. But you are a God ready to forgive, gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and did not forsake them. Later in his prayer in verse 31, he goes on and says, nevertheless, in your great mercies, you did not make an end of them or forsake them, for you are a gracious and merciful God. The psalmist in Psalm 103 verse 8, the Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. Jeremiah later again, just at the time of the captivity in chapter 32 and verse 18, Jeremiah says, you show steadfast love to thousands. And again, reaching back to that ancient theme in Israel of God being such a merciful God. And so, you know, they really had a very sophisticated grasp on the fact that God was compassionate, God was merciful. And it's one of those wonderful attributes that, in fact, we need to get a good handle on in our day and age as well. Now, strangely enough, right, this very attribute of God, this very theme of God being compassionate, becomes the grounds for a complaint actually against God. And we see Jonah in chapter 4 and verse 2. Jonah actually complains to God about the fact that he is so merciful, that he is such a gracious and such a compassionate God. He's annoyed with God over the fact that he is like this. Chapter 4 and verse 2 of Jonah, and he prayed to the Lord and said, O Lord, is this not what I said when I was yet in my country? That is why I made haste to flee to Tarshish, for I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and relenting from disaster. So in this particular instance, Jonah is really upset with God because God has had mercy on the Ninevites. God was had planned to unleash judgment on them. But through the ministry of Jonah, God had compassion upon these people. God had mercy on the Ninevites, and his hand at this, you know, a stay of execution was secured, and they were spared from God's judgment. And this really annoyed Jonah. He was so angry. Why did God have mercy on these guys? Why was God compassionate with them? They're so wicked, they deserve to be destroyed. And so what a wonderful thing, this theme of compassion that we find of God. God being such a compassionate God. And in fact, this theme was so persistent that it even made its way into the wisdom literature in the Old Testament. And that's why we find, you know, when you read through the books of Job and Psalms and Proverbs, Ecclesiastes and Song of Solomon, we just find this concept of this theme of God's mercy, God's compassion, just oozing through the scripture. And it just leaps out and reaches out to us as we see people in their situations during their lives, relying on it or remembering it or sharing it with others around them, and this great theme of God. Now, as we come to an end today, I want to, you know, take things up a notch at this point and just say to you that however constant and however embedded in the scriptures and in Israelite history this theme of God's compassion was, there was a rival theme that was so pervasive that it almost eclipsed God's compassion. And this rival theme was the wrath of God. The wrath of God, God's wrath. Now, the frequency with which the wrath of God makes an appearance in Scripture tends almost to overshadow the more comforting aspect of God's compassion. And once again, we're being exposed here to those less comforting aspects of God's nature, just in the same way that we become uncomfortable when we see God saying things like he did to Abram, to take your son and to go and kill him and then burn him as a sacrifice. Now we start talking about God's wrath. Okay, and we're not just as comfortable embracing this attribute of God. We're not just as comfortable immersing ourselves in the reality of the wrath of God. We naturally swing to the mercy of God and the compassion of God and God's gracious ways with us, and we naturally warm to those attributes. But as soon as we start talking about God's wrath, all of a sudden, we're not just as comfortable. And the thing is, the manifestation of God's wrath in Scripture almost eclipses the manifestation of God's compassion. And that's funny, because when we think about the songs that we sing, when we think about the hymns that have been written, when we think about, you know, Christian literature and Christian poetry, it's interesting to me that so much of what we sing and so much of what we read tends to be an expression of praise and adoration for God, for his compassion and for his grace and for his mercy. And how many hymns have we sung, you know, in recent years, where the emphasis is on the wrath of God? How many opportunities of worship have we ever found because of God's wrath? All right. Well, I'll tell you one character who got it right, who got the balance, and that was the psalmist in Psalm 136. And he says the following, and he touches on this, you know, and he says, give thanks to him who killed the firstborn of Egypt. His faithful love endures forever. He brought Israel out of Egypt. His faithful love endures forever. He acted with a strong hand and a powerful arm. His faithful love endures forever. Give thanks to him who parted the Red Sea. His faithful love endures forever. He led Israel safely through. His faithful love endures forever. But he hurled Pharaoh and his army into the Red Sea. His faithful love endures forever. Give thanks to him who led his people through the wilderness. His faithful love endures forever. Give thanks to him who struck down mighty kings. His faithful love endures forever. He killed powerful kings. His faithful love endures forever. And so he goes on, you know. And so, folks, it's interesting that so much of our theology is informed by God's mercy and God's compassion and God's grace. And rightly so, because, you know, the entire New Testament hinges on the fact of the love of God, right? For God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten son. All right. The entire New Testament covenant hinges on the love of God. Okay. But that's not to diminish this other aspect of God, and that is the wrath of God, God's wrath. You know, and I think that God wants us to immerse ourselves, not just in all the nice comfortable bits about his personality and about his character, his person. God doesn't want us just to be au fait with all the, you know, the comforting attributes associated with himself. God also wants us to be familiar and to be versed also in these more stern aspects of his person and of his character. And you see, if we don't do that, we're going to have an imbalanced idea and picture of who God is. And our approach to God isn't going to be adequately informed. And we very quickly can lose sight of actually who God truly is if we diminish this theme of the wrath of God. And we can become frivolous, and we can become trivial, and we can become, you know, almost, we can almost become blasphemous in the way we worship God, in the way we approach God, and the way with we represent God. We can misrepresent God in the world around us when we lose sight of the wrath of God. And the Lord wants us to tangle with that. He wants us to embrace that. And I think that when it came, you know, to this sacrifice, this monstrous test that God gave to Abram, he was stepping across into, you know, stepping across from the comforting aspects of God's nature, God's compassion, God's mercy, and he was going out into the deep, big, deep blue waters of the other side of God's person and of God's character. And this is something that the Lord wants us to embrace. He wants us to know that what he is like, in his whole being, his whole person, in the best way that we can understand him as human beings. And God wants us to embrace these things. And so next week, we're going to pick up a little bit more with this aspect of who God is. And so we've seen today this tremendous ability, this tremendous practice of God to call people into his service after he's prepared them. And you be ready. Maybe God is going to come knocking on your door and he's going to give you a job to do for him. Maybe God is going to bring across your life in his providence the fact that he wants you to serve him in a more full-time capacity, in a more serious way. And that'll be a wonderful thing, right? And it'd be great if God did that in our little church in Straid, okay? But God also wants us to become a little bit more properly oriented in how we think about God, and that there's a very serious aspect and dimension to God's nature as well. And in fact, this is not to chase us from God, but it is designed to draw us to God. A little bit scary, maybe, yes, but it is designed to draw us closer to him. And may God help us in these days in that way. Trust that you've maybe heard something or learned something new for the first time today. And we trust that God will help us all in our journey of faith in these days. Let's close in a word of prayer together. Heavenly Father, we are glad today of these moments around the scriptures. We're glad of an opportunity just to explore a little more the life of Abram. We're glad, Lord, of an opportunity to just to interact with the scriptures and to expose ourselves to the teaching of your word. We are comforted by the fact of your compassion, and we thank you for the 103rd Psalm and how that you make us to see that you, like a father, pities his children, and how he is tender and compassionate with them. So you are with the saints. And Lord, this deeply encourages us, and we thank you for that tremendous and beautiful picture. But we want, Lord, to be balanced in our understanding of you. We want, Lord, to realize that there is a stern element and aspect to your person and to your nature and to what you are doing in this world around us. And so we pray that you will enable us in these days to expand our mindset and our view of God, our understanding of God, and Lord, to be prepared to embrace those parts of Scripture that maybe are a little bit alarming and at sometimes maybe even a little bit scary. But Lord, we want to draw close to you. We want to really understand you more, and we want to be more useful in your service in these days. And so we ask that you will help us each one to embrace you wholeheartedly, fully, unreservedly. We pray this thing of you in Jesus' name. Amen.
All my righteousness, nothing but the